our choir, piano, and theater concert. We are so excited that all of you came tonight to see these wonderful students and their hard work. We appreciate your contributions. Many of you are friends and families, and you are encouraging to them, and we appreciate that so much. My name is Catherine Latham. I have the honor and privilege of being the teacher of these students. I do teach piano as well as choir and theater class this year. So we're excited to show you a little bit of each of those programs tonight. You'll notice that the name of our program today, hopefully you got a program there as you entered, is not listed here, but we have put it everywhere else around the school. The name of our concert tonight, besides Spring Concert, we have labeled it, Together We Will Be the Change. Together We Will Be the Change. You'll notice that many of our songs tonight talk about making a difference in the world. We believe that choir and the arts, theater, piano, these are things that can change our lives. And we can come together appreciating the fine arts, and our differences seem to kind of fade away when we work together as musicians, as actors, as instrumentalists. We tend to forget about our differences and come together to enjoy the fine arts as one group. So I hope that you understand that's what we're trying to do with our programs here, is to come together and to be the change where people see how we can work together as one group and one community. So I want to welcome you. Each group will have some students introducing the songs. We have a variety of music, variety of styles, and I hope you enjoy it all. Thank you for coming.
The song Rockin' Robin was originally recorded by Bobby Day in 1958 and was covered by several artists in the 1960s and 1970s. But its most popular cover was that of Jackson 5 in 1972, with Michael Jackson singing the solo.
Really gonna rock tonight. Sweet, 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 swe next song, entitled Brave, celebrates the power of the human spirit and the connections between us. This contemporary pop song by Sarah Bareilles encourages people to speak up and advocate for themselves.
Called Best Day of My Life was recorded by the group of American authors in 2014. One of the composers stated, "We wanted to tell the story of how no matter what's going on, whether you're stuck at your job or having a bad day, there's always an escape from that. And there's always a way to make any day the best day of your life."
Oh,
That was our central singers. That is one of our beginning choir groups. Most of them have only been in choir 1 year, and we're excited that they're embarking on their choir experience and being a part of that. So we're very proud of those students and what they have learned. You have now coming a group of ladies. This is our ladies ensemble. They are going to, this is a newly formed group, and they're excited to sing in a foreign language for you, which is not very easy. So they're going to be getting in place, and then we will let them introduce their song for you. This is our ladies ensemble.
Dos Oruguitas is from the popular movie Encanto. It tells the story of two caterpillars in love. They navigate the world together and for a time are inseparable. Before finding themselves cocooned and alone, the two creatures don't want to let each other go, but they realize that they need to in order to fulfill their destinies. By the end, now grown into beautiful butterflies, they know that it is their time to fly apart and find their own future. This song will be sung in Spanish. Here is a translation of part of the song. Don't you hold on too tight. Both of you know it's your time to go, to fly apart, to reunite. Wonders surround you. Just let the walls come down. Don't look behind you. Fly till you find your way toward tomorrow. We would like to dedicate this song to our seniors who are ready to embark on their own journey. We wish you all well in your future endeavors.
Seguirás, y así.
In 2020, of all years, when things were going kind of crazy in our world, as a pandemic had hit us, we were fortunate enough to, in spite of that pandemic, to raise, through the gifts of many generous donors and grants, but particularly a group of alumni that really donated over half of the cost for a piano lab. Those of you who don't know what a piano lab is, it is a room full of digital pianos. That means they can plug in. One of our coaches said, "Boy, that's going to be loud. How are y'all going to do anything when you do that?" I said, "Well, they all practice with headphones." And so then he was like, "Oh, okay, I get it now." So we started in 2020 with our first class of piano students. We had one class, and we taught half of them at home online. And you're like, how did they do that? Those people had to have their own keyboard or piano. And I did a lot of holding my book up to my screen and going, okay, this is what it looks like. This is what it looks like on the piano. And then I would turn my screen until we taught those students that were home. We had half at home and half in person. This is our third year now of having a piano class. We actually have three piano classes now. We have over 50 students that are studying piano, and they get to practice during the day and learn how to play the piano. And we're going to share with you three of those individuals tonight. Since we have over 50 students, we just asked a few of our top students to come and present to you tonight. Brianna Long, this is your... Come on down, dear. Thought she was coming while I was talking. This is the first year you've ever had piano in your whole life, right? Right. Brianna has never had piano before she came in the fall to study piano. She's going to be coming to the piano. Brianna is a senior. We did a survey this week of what they thought they had learned at piano and what they thought about the class. And Brianna's comment was that I just love. She said, "This is one of the most rewarding classes that I think I've ever had." Because she said, "I learned something from start to finish, and I can really play music, and I am enjoying that so much." So I love that comment. So Bree is going to play a piece for us that is a modern piece. It means it was just recently composed, and it's entitled Alone. Our next performer is going to do something a little different. We also have a theater class, and throughout this semester, we've been doing some projects, and one of those projects is to write a monologue. A monologue, if you didn't know, is where you present something as one individual person. There was a stipulation on their monologue that they had to write about someone that was important to them in history, that they thought had made an impact in history. And they had to write as if they were going to write about that person or as if they were that person. And they had to share that. Now, I was just totally taken aback the first time that this young man told me. I asked several of them early on in the year, "What do you want to be when you grow up? What are your plans after you leave?" And this student said, "I want to be a race car driver." And I went, "Oh, okay. I just never thought of that." But he is committed to being a race car driver. He knows everything about race car driving. I knew nothing about race car driving until I met Aaron Sharp. And he has taught me a lot about race car driving. So his monologue is about a person that is very important in the race car, in the racing world. And so Aaron is going to come and share a monologue with you.
Is it on? Cool. Is it okay if I turn this just to have it? Sweet. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I've got closer. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I did this monologue on a driver known as Niki Lauda, who unfortunately passed away in 2019. But he was a very influential driver, and he went through a lot. So this is just a monologue I did on his life, and I'm doing it through the eyes of him as if he wrote a letter to his kids. So, yeah. Good afternoon. My name is Nicholas Andreas Lauda. I'm writing this out to my kids, Max and Mia, my two youngest. However, anyone is open to reading this. Fans, family, friends, teammates, peers, anyone out there who wants to hear about my story. I was born in 1949, February 22nd, 1949, in Vienna, Austria, to Ernst Peter Lauda and Elizabeth Lauda. We both, my parents owned a paper manufacturing company. So growing up, I didn't have to worry about money or anything like that. But my parents wanted me to take their business and wanted me to go into that, but that's not what I wanted. I had a passion for racing. They claimed it was barbaric and overall a stupid idea, but I didn't care what they thought. I took any money they gave me to go race, whether it be sports cars, open wheel cars, anything. I did the Formula 2 championship for a bit and even took the title in 1972. And I dabbled with small little teams in Formula 1 here and there, nothing major. I went to my parents and tried to arrange a deal where they give me money so I could go and compete big time, full time in Formula 1. They said I was crazy and said that our name belonged in business and politics and yada yada, but I wanted nothing to do with that. I looked my dad in the eyes and told him that he would regret the day that I was all over the papers and I was champion and he was stuck in a paper manufacturing company. I went to the biggest bank in all of Austria and took out a giant loan to go and bribe a team to give me a seat. I landed on a team by the name of BRM. They were a smaller team, but they were willing to give me a shot. So I took it in, and their car was terrible, absolutely terrible, slower than everybody else. But looking at it inside and out, I could find anything wrong with it, and I would fix it. And I went to the boss, and I told him this wasn't right. I could fix this car, and I can make it better. And he said I was crazy, and I made a deal with him. If I can make the car any way faster, I got a contract that earned me as much as my teammate, Clay Regazzoni, and I got a full-time ride for the rest of the year. And I said if I didn't make it any faster, then he was free to kick me out and find someone else to take my seat. So I worked day and night for a week with mechanics, making sure that car could be in its tip-top condition. And then the day came for testing. My teammate took the car out, and it went our usual time, very slow. He took the car I made out, went 3 seconds faster, which I know doesn't seem like much, but in racing, that 3 seconds can be the difference between last and winning. Ultimately, we didn't win, but we definitely were getting closer. And apparently this was enough to attract the attention of Ferrari, the biggest team at the time. So I signed with them for the 1975 season and helped them develop their car a little bit more, which helped me dominate that season. There was a little British fellow who was poking his head in, though, James Hunt. He wasn't much to me as he barely could win anything and his car wasn't much, but he definitely almost halted me once or twice. He was a quick driver nonetheless. And I expected nothing much out of the 1976 season other to win. But I was wrong, very wrong. I was fine, thinking everything would be cool. But then I heard Hunt had signed with McLaren, who were our biggest competitors at the time. Now, this worried me, because I knew he was a quick driver and could do very well in a car like that. But I acted as if it was nothing, because that's just who I am. I didn't want it to make it seem like it bothered me to show weakness. So I went into that season not thinking much of it, winning races here and there at the start, but so did Hunt. Now granted, I would pick at his car any way I could, find anything that was wrong with it. There was one time I found it was overweight, but one instance I loved was in Monaco, when I found that his car was just 1.3 centimeters too long. Now, this got them disqualified unless they could fix it, and they did, but it made their car extremely unreliable, which would let me dominate most of that going into most of the races going into the summer break. Over the summer break, I would then marry my current girlfriend, Marlene Noss, and we had a happy relationship, and it boosted my spirits even more coming into August for the first race out of the summer break. Now, this race happened to be at a track in Germany known as the Nürburgring. It's the most dangerous track in the world, with sharp turns, small corners, and everything you could think of that make it too dangerous to race on. Even in normal conditions, completely beautiful weather and all that, it was still a dangerous track. But this day, it was pouring rain, and I felt that it was too dangerous. So I tried to call a meeting, tried to cancel it, but no one really wanted to do that with me. So the race commenced. I was on pole position starting first. Hunt was in second. The flag waved, and off we went. Now, we were hounding each other, pushing each other into the grass, cutting corners, anything we could do to beat each other. But then his teammate just seemingly flew by us, whilst he was on slick tires, and we were on the wet weather tires, which slowed us down immensely. We both went into the pits, but a tire getting stuck and a bunch of traffic caused me to get stuck in the pits while Hunt was able to be freely gone. The second I had the opportunity, I floored it, which might have been a little illegal, but oh well. I was just blowing past everybody, trying to catch him, to the point I went up to this one hill and jumped it, which I felt messed with something, but I couldn't tell what it was just yet, until I felt something snap while I was going over two fast curves where I'd end up losing the car and running into a wall at over 280 kilometers an hour. And the second I heard the bang, my helmet flew off and I was spinning before I finally got stopped and all there was just flames everywhere. I couldn't tell what was going on, but all I could tell you was I couldn't breathe and I could barely see. Before I knew it, I was pulled out, but I didn't want to open my eyes. I thought I was dead. I was rushed to the hospital where I had to get my lungs vacuumed and drained 3 times. And I was there for 40 days, watching Hunt dominate as I was gone and slowly closing the gap to me in the championship. But I didn't want to let that happen. So against both Marlene and the hospital's wishes, I went back to race in Italy 40 days later. Now, granted, it was a dumb idea. I wasn't fully recovered, but I didn't want to lose, so I went into it just how I wanted to. I started on fourth, which where I didn't want to start, but it was nothing bad. I ended up managing to stay in fourth despite all the pain and whatnot. So I didn't gain any points over Hunt as he won, but he closed the gap, but I was still up front. And he would take the other two races before we came into the last one in Japan. It was the season finale. He was just a few points behind me, and all he had to do to beat me was finish in third. And I had to win, and he had to finish out of the top three. The race commenced, and we were off. I was leading for a good bit before Hunt went around me. And ultimately, I went into the pit box without any sort of warning. My team was confused as could be, but I told them it was too dangerous. I didn't want to have an accident like I did again. So Hunt went on to win that title, and I let him have it. Now, many people thought we hated each other. We were just two men who were willing to do whatever it takes to win. And then 1977 came. I would get my second title in Formula One and ultimately retire from the sport. And I would just enjoy my vacation for a bit, even started my own airline company. This would then lead on for a bit until 1981, where I got a call from McLaren, the team I spent years beating, who wanted me to race for them. The first 2 years were nothing special, few wins here and there, but it wasn't anything I was too thrilled about until 1983. Now that season, I don't know what happened, but I dominated that season and took another title before ultimately retiring again after that season and going back to my airline company, which I stuck with for a few years until 2002, where I ended up in a chairman position for Ferrari, my old team, and then moved to Jaguar team principal in 2003, where I would stay for a year before realizing that team was a dumpster fire and ultimately leaving them back into retirement. Come 2009, that's when you two were born, Max and Mia. And ultimately, you know the rest from there. Mr. Wolf came and signed me on to the Mercedes team as a non-executive chairman, and I would go on to help that team create some of the best cars the world has ever seen. Now, I know I'm in this hospital in Switzerland, and you're nowhere near me. You're in Monaco with the team. And the doctor said I don't have long left before this kidney failure will get to me. So I just want to let you all know that I love you, and I'll see you next time.
The first time Aaron did that in class, he had every bit of that memorized. And he wrote that whole monologue himself. I bet you didn't have to research much of it. You already knew most of it, didn't you? He already knew that. It's pretty cool. It's pretty neat to see when someone has a passion for something and they can share that with other classmates. It's pretty exciting. Very proud of you, Aaron. Good job. All right, next we have the joy of hearing another pianist. Kyla Bonds is a sophomore. She had never had piano class prior to August. That's correct, right? Okay, that is correct. Kyla has enjoyed piano. You can see her working very diligently. She will even come into the choir room and say, I want to play the piano. And she likes to practice every chance she gets. She will be playing a contemporary piece that is by Andrea and Trevor Dow, and it is entitled Beacon. We have a little time of changing, if you'll excuse us for that. We have the concert choir that is coming into place now. Our concert choir students, the majority of them have had at least 1 year of choir experience. Most of them have. Some of them have been with us for 4 years. They began actually as freshmen, and they have continued all 4 years. So we're excited. We have actually 10, hard to believe, seniors this year, 10 seniors. Yes, they're having a little difficulty because this is quite an ordeal for them to, some of them have to go around. It's okay. It's all right. It's all right. So we have 10 seniors. We'll be introducing them a little bit later. We're very proud of their work. They have grown. They have developed. They have, many of them are doing things they've never done before. Some of these folks that might have a solo have never had a solo before. And some of those students are people that are actually just fairly new to choir. All right, we're getting there. All right. Well, we are excited to begin a set of three pieces for you tonight for the concert choir, and then we will merge together with both choirs, and you will see we have learned a number of songs together. The first song is by one of my favorite artists, which is Stevie Wonder, and now that we've got everybody in place, I'll let someone else introduce that song for you.
The song Don't You Worry About a Thing was released by Stevie Wonder in 1973 and recently covered by John Legend. This song has a Latin feel and even includes Spanish lyrics near the end. The lyrics encourage everyone to let go of their worries. The Spanish lyrics, loosely translated, mean everything's really awesome.
Everybody's got a thing, but some don't know how to handle it.
Before Sydney shares about this next song, Underdog, the first time I heard it, it took me a minute to understand what it was about. I heard it and I thought, underdog, that's usually somebody that is looked down upon. But this song, which Sydney's going to share, is about encouraging that person that we might call the underdog. So I want you to listen as she introduces that and really listen for the words of this song.
The song Underdog was recorded by Alicia Keys in 2020. The song highlights all of the regular people who work so hard just to stay afloat in the world, and it's a tribute, to those who can rise above their struggles. Alicia Keys said the following about the song. Some people may think of the word underdog as a negative word. But I... Yes.
Sometimes we get tickled when we get nervous. It's all right. Okay, what she was going to share is a comment by the composer, Alicia Keys, who is a famous, very famous, contemporary pop African-American singer and pianist. And what she wrote is, she said, some people may think of the word underdog as a negative word, but I see it as a powerful word, representing people who may be underestimated and yet still rise to the challenge and exceed expectations. I love this song so much because it's about real life and real people and our experiences.
She asked him his name and told him what hers was. She gave him a story about a life with a glint in his eye and a corner of a smile. One conversation, the things that change us. If we notice when we look up,
sometimes this and I would never make it, but I was built to break the mold. The only dream that I've been chasing is my own. So I sing a song for the hustlers chasing at the bus stop. Single mothers waiting on a check to call young teachers. Student doctors, sons on the front line, knowing they don't get to run. This goes out to the underdog. Keep on keeping at what you love. You'll find that someday soon enough, you will rise up.
Mind. She looked in his eye in a mirror and he smiled. One conversation, a single moment, the things that change us. And we notice when we look up sometimes.
They said I would never make it, but I was built to break the mold. The only dream that I've been chasing is my own. So I sing a song for the hustlers shaking at the bus stop. Single mothers waiting on a check to call young teachers. Doctors, sons on the front line, knowing they don't get to run. This goes out to the underdog. Keep on keeping at what you love. You'll find that someday soon enough, you will rise up.
Single
The song A Million Dreams is written by Benji Pazik and Justin Paul for the soundtrack of the movie The Greatest Showman. The song encourages us to pursue our dreams to make the world a better place to be.
See a world that's waiting up for me that I call my own. Through the dark, through the door, through where no one's been before, but it feels like home.
Oh,
I'm very excited to see the world that these students are going to make. I'm going to ask that our gentlemen are going to move, our ladies are going to sit, and we're going to have the joy of hearing another piano student. Haley Tuzera had not had piano, as far as I know, Haley, correct me if I'm wrong, until August of last year. Is that correct? And Haley has just loved it. I can tell she lights up when she comes to practice piano in the piano lab. She loves it. When others were given an opportunity to learn certain pieces for their exam, she said, "Can I learn something else? And this something else is more difficult." And she went for it. And so this is her choice, and this is her exam piece, and she has chosen to do an arrangement of the contemporary version of Amazing Grace. I'm very proud of Haley Tuzera.
Thank you.
give a hand to all three of our pianists that have played tonight. Excellent job. Very excited to see how they grow and mature in their musicianship as they hopefully maybe will continue. Although two of those young ladies are seniors, but I hope that they've started their love for piano and I hope they'll continue. And one of those young ladies is a sophomore, so we hope we have a little more time with her. You'll notice that our ladies are merging together. We have a ladies' chorus piece to share with you. Some of us attended Lee University Honor Choir, and this is one of the pieces that the ladies' choir learned. And our ladies enjoyed it so much, they asked if we could sing it together with all of our ladies because they loved this piece. So this is what we are going to present for you now.
Wayfair and Stranger is an Appalachian folk song. This unique arrangement of that old traditional song is created by Reginald Arthur Sessner and will be sung by our ladies' choir today.
The song, The song Together was originally performed by the group for King and Country, also featuring Kirk Franklin and Tori Kelly. This is a song of hope and overcoming challenges together. The message of this song reminds us that we should work together as a community to help each other and encourage one another throughout life.
The next song, Keep Your Lamps, is a traditional spiritual which originated in the days of slavery. The phrase had multiple meanings, but often was sung to encourage slaves to stay alert and positive, because conductors of the Underground Railroad could be in the area and be able to help them escape to safety. This is arranged by African-American composer Victor C. Johnson.
Keep your lamps Be the Change by Laura Farnell reminds us that we all have the ability to make a difference in the world, combining texts from Gandhi, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., and Matthew 5:15 from the Bible. Along the original lyrics, the piece also incorporates the song, This Little Light of Mine. You will hear a portion of the lyrics are in the Swahili language.
We wanted to let you know that one of our soloists could not be here tonight, so our understudy will be taking this solo. We have the soloist tonight, Natalie Dominguez. Then Sydney Torrey will be singing our second solo, and then our third solo in this piece will be Kylie Smith. Wanted to let you know that. Okay, Natalie will introduce our song.
Hello? Okay. This song, You Will Be Found, is from a Broadway musical called Dear Evan Hansen. It speaks about people who feel as if they're alone and no one cares about them. The song then turns around to be an encouragement to everyone, stating that there are people who are here for us along the way. We encourage you to remember that we are here to help and support one another no matter what we encounter.
Have you ever felt like nobody was there? Have you ever felt forgotten in the middle of nowhere? Have you ever felt like you could disappear? Like you could fall and no one would hear? So let that lonely feeling wash away. Cause maybe there's a reason to believe you'll be okay. Cause when you don't feel strong enough to stand, you can reach out.
Crash! This song, Lovely Day, is by R. Robert T. Gibson. And this song describes our choir as a whole. No matter wherever you go through in life, just always remember that it will forever be a lovely day.